Berry Accius, B-E-R-R-Y, A-C-C-I-U-S. You can have, check me out on Facebook, Twitter. I'm not really a Twitter guy. I'm trying to do my Twitter thing, trying to get up there. But Facebook, I'm on there all the time. And I'm saying a few different things that, you know, some of you guys may like, some of you guys may like, eh. But I was thinking today, I was inspired by Dr. Joy. Dr. Joy was great, wasn't she? Oh, yeah. And because it weighs on my heart, I don't want to just talk about success in the sense of just being in the school and, you know, getting your degree. Because at the end of the day, I need to talk about it since we have our people in here. And I had this great conversation with one of the faculty members here at Sierra College, and we were talking about race. And Dr. Joy was talking about race. And she said something that was really, like, that resonated in my heart. Do understand you're black in America. Do you guys understand that? So I like to always start off and say, peace, King. Peace. Let's go, let's do it again. Peace, King.
Peace,
King.
Peace,
peace, Queen. Peace. Let's change the language up. Heard some of the people walking over here and I heard the N-word popping off. What's up, my N? What's up, my N? It's all good. And in reality, are we really that? And at the end of the day, who gave us that N-word to use? Now, my conversation is usually going to be uncomfortable for some people who don't want to realize what's going on in current day because some people have a privilege. Who y'all think got that privilege? Say it loud.
White people.
White people. And white people have to understand they live with this privilege, and it's okay to a certain extent. Understanding your privilege and what you're doing with that privilege to move us people forward that have been laid down to rest. As I turned on the news, and in North Carolina, that police officer that killed that young black brother, that young king who was going to college just like him, killed him dead on the street because he was knocking on the door looking for help. Mistrial. He walks. Another black male mourned. So can I really, at the state of America, just talk about school success? How can I talk about that when really America is telling me right now, it don't matter if you get your degree, brother. It don't matter if you get your degree, sister. They still gonna think of you as. So when we have to situate our language and tone that down and start speaking life into ourselves before we can gain life for someone else, because when we holler Black Lives Matter, does it really matter to ourselves? I'm kind of done with the Black Lives Matter. I'm more like Black Power Matters. Say that a few times in a room full of people that ain't all your color. And when I say Black Power Matters, it's not being disrespectful, but it's being truthful. How many of y'all watch the show Power? Yeah, my man's like, oh, what? Guilty pleasure of mine too. But if you watch Power, for those who watch it, Power, you see this man, and in the second episode, you know, the white guy had him all clutched up in the club, and you know, he's trying to be the top guy in the little drug game. He's trying to have power in his relationship. He's trying to balance a whole bunch of stuff, right? But in the reality, isn't that what we all want, a balance to be on top? That's all it is about power, having your own. Because he was trying to get out of the game to move to something else that was greater, right? That ain't nothing wrong with that. You don't hear white people say white power. Why? Because they're in power. Why are you going to have to say white power when you're in power? Ain't no need for that. And then if you do say white power, it's usually that racist prejudice thing. But the thing about it, it's not in the hoodies walking around. It's in good old corporate America. A majority of y'all who believe that when you graduate, you will go and you will get a pass. You are no longer one of those Negroes. You're one of us. But ask Bill Cosby how that feels. I'm just going to say raw truth because I don't have that much time and I don't know when I'm going to go. But I have to inform every individual in here. As I talked to one of your colleagues, a white male, and we spoke candidly, I was not afraid to have this conversation about race. This is a conversation we have to have. Because every single time we delay the conversation, every single time we pretend it's not there, another brother gets murdered. Another cop says, I was in fear of my life. Another sister gets killed in a jail cell, suicide. And then when you look back and you see it's going on in all different states, when do you think it's going to start happening in California? Good old Sacramento. Good old Rockland. Where everybody's walking here on eggshells. Walking around like... Charlie, just hope he doesn't say anything to us right now. And the reason why we have to talk about this is because if we do not talk about this, there is going to be a thing called a race war. People are going to have to choose sides. And it don't matter what success rate you have here in college, you are going to have to be accounted for to what side you're going to be on. Because in truth and reality, all through our lives, unfortunately, especially for our African Americans in here, we've been lied to about our history, about who we are, and guess where it was from? This place called a school. So as you sit here, thinking about I'm going to be successful, you got to think about what information are you grabbing? How is that marinating on your mind? I always challenge every single person in life to go farther than what they tell you in the classroom. Because once you find out that you go further in what in the classroom, you learn a lot more. Do you know that just past yesterday, there was a great moment in history that we don't really talk about that just happened. Because somebody to throw that out there. August 24th, a long time ago, I'll give you a hint, 1800, something happened that triggered another national event that happened in America. See, if you're on your history, you're going to really know what happened. I said his name. Nat Turner. There you go. But too many people were still probably worried about Drake and Meek and what they doing. Is Nicki going to pop her booty? I mean, I'm just being honest. Because right here, we should have been celebrating a man who was courageous enough to say, I want my freedom. I want my power. I want to exist. Nat Turner died in a slave rebellion and nobody even paid attention or even cared to know about it. And understand right now, we are currently in 2015, August 22nd. We are still fighting for our freedom. They speak of equality, but how is equality happening that every single time a black male, a black female, a black child is being murdered in the street, whether it be by the hands of our own or by the police, and nothing happens? Now, you are the generation that can move forward to make something happen, but I ask and I challenge you, you get your degree, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Are you just going to go find, oh, I got my degree, and or are you going to get your degree and give back to your people? Because too many of us get schooled, get knowledge, and get going. Too many of us get that money from a sports team and get going. Too many of us get that money, get out the hood from rapping, singing and dancing, and they don't remember. So when we talk about black power, how can black power be when we don't have nobody reaching back to show us what power really means? And not existing in power in a fact of we want to disrespect any other person, any other nationality, but the unfortunate thing to get power for ourselves. Because it makes me sick when I cannot see a restaurant that represents me. It makes me sick that I cannot go to a wash house that represents me. It makes me sick that I don't see enough black teachers teaching me or my kids. You should have a problem with that. I have a problem with that. So when we truly talk about success, I can't sit there and speak on success on the level of I'm being successful because, yeah, I'm here right now. I lived that life. I got away from the trenches. I am so thankful that the Most High has allowed me and gave me a gift that I didn't know I had to be able to speak and resonate truth and come out of a lifestyle and be able to be here polished, not perfect, but polished enough to go ahead and give a message to my people. Because I believe even though you're not black, you are all my people who want change. I'm blessed, but I'm one of the carriers of this burden. When I see the news and I talk to my friends in Ferguson, and after a year of Mike Brown, Ferguson is still Ferguson. And we're not talking about it. And we're not doing anything about it. Because we are so afraid to discuss this race. The faculty member even told me, him being a white faculty member, said that they get upset when I start to bring up race topics. Why would that happen? Because so many people are okay. This form is okay. I cannot be comfortable. In order for us to stop what's going on currently today, we must be uncomfortable. We must be able to challenge the norm. We must be able to say the things that we've learned, the system that has been placed, needs to be destroyed. And you, brave young souls, could be the individuals that can mark your true success, not by the success of your own merit as an individual, but the success of you as a group, as a team, as a nation, as a people. And I've come from the trenches to where I used to be that idiotic, get that money, get that paper, holler at her, what's up, baby, you know what I'm saying? I used to be all that, poisoning my community, doing the whole bit. I used to live that life, but then I saw how it wasn't, you know, moving forward for my people overall. And if we have so many people spewing hatred and ignorance, I gotta be one to stand out like my forefathers before me, my brothers that sat there and gave their life. Brothers took bullets for what we are feeding, fighting for right now. I got to, because I know the young, hungry lions in here, the game changers in here, the people that have resilience, has truth, that are not kind of combattered and battered with all the stuff that some of us older people are. And I'm not that too old. I ain't gonna talk about that. You got that many grades. But I'm just I know that with the generation now and what I've seen across the board, if you guys argue, yell, scream, fight, if our white colleagues stand right by our side, don't get upset when we talk about black power. Don't get upset when we talk about race first, because it's always race first for y'all. It's just seen throughout this whole United States. Don't be upset when we start saying, we want this, we want that. Be okay with it and say, we want to help you get that. And when we get that, you not say, where's my hat at? No, let that go. Because here's the thing. And I'm going to leave you with this. This is how our America plays. Every single nationality that's gone through something horrific that has done with the Holocaust, with the genocide of the Indians, every single one, with the Jews, the Asians, the Indians, Chinese, all of them got something. They got their monies, they got land, and they got sent on their way. And even, this is a kicker if y'all don't know, the slave owners, hear me what I'm about to say. Oh yeah, I'm about to get church on it right now. The slave owners, when the slaves were set free, they was given, at this time, $300 per slave. Tell me if that's a fair advantage for us. Every single person that has had something happen in their culture got something except us. They fear our power. But I'm here to sit there and say, we don't even care about all that. Just give us what you owe and we can be done. Because see, the thing about it, you got to really understand something. If the government that we have currently today, and I hope everyone's not on no patriotic thing, I'm here to burst your bubble. If they really care to make a dramatic change, I know full well when they want to do something, they'll take care of it. Black Panthers was a good thing for the black community. They wasn't perfect, but that was a good thing, because guess what was happening? The same things are happening right now. Police brutality. We just don't got brave enough brothers and sisters that's that bold. I'm trying to tell y'all to be bold. And when they decided to destroy and dismantle the Panthers, they did so. But yet we keep on hearing this war on drugs, a.k.a. the war on black people. The war on terrorists, a.k.a. trying to intimidate, a.k.a. trying to keep you sidetracked from what the real truth is. Keep you paranoid. That's the war on your mind. Keep you paranoid. Every single war that the government has propelled us to think that we're fighting ain't never won. But you ain't never heard a war on poverty. Ain't never heard a war on mass incarceration. Ain't heard these things. Because they don't want to do. So you have to be understanding when you come up in here as a student, you get and you suck up all the information. But as a person that has to love more than yourself, gotta love those people in front and the back of you, we have our civil duty to correct the mistakes that have been made and to change what is here to be changed, because it has to be changed, because we cannot longer live in these conditions. These conditions are no longer feasible for any of us to live in, whether it's white or black. Things must change. If they don't, we'll never hear this thing, what we call equality. And an Asian lady, she walked by. She had a Yankee cap too, right? I said, okay, Yankee fan, that's what's up. Throw my fist up, was at me. She walks, she stops, she turns around. And what came out of her mouth clearly let me know that this fight has not fallen only to just the white American, but this fight has looked globally as what individuals look at black American, black people in general. So after the lady looks, she looks at me, ups and down, I look at her, like, how you doing? She says, and I don't like using the word, and I'm not going to, so I'm gonna paraphrase it. She said, are you a Yankees fan for real, or are you one of those ends that just wear the hat? Pause. I said, wait a minute, hold up. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, remember what I'm telling you. Just a simple, older-looking Asian woman, you think that knows better? I said, hold up. I said, excuse me? I just had to get that back. Because I want to believe she didn't say it, but I know she said it. So boldly, she says, like, well, you didn't hear me? Like, I said, are you? And she repeated the same line. And she was sincere and serious about it. And then she said, and I'm in shock. Like, at that point in time, black man, what do you do? I got choices now. Black man, Sacramento downtown, you know what's close to me? The police station. And I have been, if you Google my name up, I've been kind of very mouthy on a lot of subjects, if you can tell. I've been on the forefront of social change, police brutality, so I'm speaking that talk and walking that walk. So I gotta think, like, okay, if I go flip out on her, one, my auntie gonna be like, why are you cussing out this Asian lady? Two, if I flip out, as soon as the papers get it, Barry Accius, community activist, mentor, blah, 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 attacks this poor Asian woman. No backstory that she just called me the N-word a few times. So I'm thinking in my head, like, what am I supposed to do? And plus, I'm irritated as hell. I just slept at the airport. I'm coming from the East Coast back home to the West Coast, and now I'm getting called the N-word. After I got all this life filled, we got to eat good old Caribbean food, and now I got to deal with this. So I got up. I said, who gave you the right to say that to me? Now she pushes. What do I do again? Do I follow her? Do I sit down? Do I Facebook it? You know, we all like to Facebook our emotions. I can't believe this Asian lady. Facebook has become the new diary that doesn't talk back, I guess. All right. So I could not just sit and do nothing, but I had to remain poised. I had to remain calm. Everything that we do in life, and this doesn't go for black or white, this goes in general, you have to think about the consequences. If you sleep in and you have a test and you know that teacher ain't for no mess, you can't look at that teacher, oh, God, brother, you know how it goes. He ain't gonna look at you like, you know what I'm saying? If he goes for the, well, know how it goes to everybody, he ain't going to be a good teacher. So I can't just sit there and just say, can I use you for example? Okay, you sure? All right, check this out a little bit. I can't do that. In my mind, I want to. I appreciate that, Queen. Because I'm angry. Because I've been fighting for equality. They told me I was free. They said I wasn't that. I don't speak that in my life. I was mad. Mm-hmm. Lord, I was tired. Mm-hmm. And I was tired of my people continuing to have to still fight this word. And not also say that 2-3 years back at a restaurant, I had to deal with the same thing with a white woman calling me and one of my mentees the N-word about 25 different times. So now here I am, I walk in, she's about to buy her ticket. I said, oh, we ain't gonna have no ticket. But if I go in, I'm gonna be the angry black man, right? Mm-hmm. Now the intimidation goes in. Yeah, oh, look at him, he's a black man. You know, he tried to hurt me. So I said, excuse me, ma'am. So you gonna buy a ticket after you did all that? Like, is that, seriously? I said, so Amtrak, you selling tickets to somebody that's racist, prejudice? They're like, what's going on? And now she's trying to fall back. Like, I don't know what you're talking about, brother. I don't know who you are. And guess who walks up? Johnny Law. Mm-hmm. Bigger white boy than me. He walks up there. And then I said, oh, so this is what's gonna happen now? And the first person he approaches is who? Of course me, right? But I was calm and I was very direct and I was very pointed. And I said, before you even ask me anything, go talk to her. Mm-hmm. Understand that? But in all of these incidents that I'm trying to explain, because you guys are going to be challenged with this, I remained calm. I thought about my 19-year-old daughter. Yes, I have a 19-year-old daughter. I thought about the kids that I mentored. And I thought about the opportunities, like right now, that I will get with beautiful people like yourselves to give you encouragement and let you know how important this battle is, the fight of how we deal with it. How we sit back and look at the bigger picture. As much as I wanted to just go off and flip out, curse her out, call her all type of your Chinese rice and all pork fried rice, and do all those things. How would have I been if I did the exact same thing to her? I would have been a racist just like her. Though black people cannot have that power, but in the degree of what people will look, that's what they would have said. And I had to remember that myself, being an agent of change, could not play that game. But I was going to make sure she heard me clear and loud that that shit would not fly. And as I talked to the police officer, and he, because he understands the moments we're in right now, he said, I get it, I understand. But I also had to tell him, I don't think you understand enough. Because if I did one thing to her, I would be going to jail. All you do is talk to her and kind of send her on her way. You will never understand what it feels to be a black man in America having to deal with this word that has poisoned my people, that have killed my brothers, that has disrespected my sisters, and has brought us back further than we've ever been, because we continue to embrace this word, this slave owner word, this word given to us by our oppressor, and embrace it like that's my homie. But you never hear any brother when they talk about laying a murder game down, I'm going to kill this king, I'm going to kill my brother. They say, I'm about to kill this mother effing in. I'm going to F this in up. You hear that? It's all pertaining to violence and aggression. So how do we use that word? And then it kills me when the women start using it. I'll be like, oh my God. First time my daughter used it, I said, please stop. Don't ever use that word, especially don't use it in front of me. This is the reality that we live in. The reality that we live in is racism is alive and well. And the reality we live in is we perpetuate it just as much as our oppressor does. Because we are finding ourselves that black people don't want to have the conversation. Because they're okay. They feel that they're exempt. You get a degree. You get some money. Oh, I'm cool. Tiger Woods tried to play the whole white card. What happened to him? I'm just being real. OJ Simpson tried to play the white card. What happened to him? He beat the murder case, and they came back and got him. Because he thought it was okay. I'm still white. I'm all right here. Oh, yes, you're OJ. And they gave that brother more years for something that he should have gotten no years for. And now currently our people are being slaughtered in America. And if anybody in this room does not have a problem with that, I don't know what to say. I don't know if I could be affiliated with you. Because if you're not worried about what's going on, because it could be your kid if it ain't you. It could be your cousin if it ain't you. It could be your granddad, your mother, if it ain't you. Every single thing that happens in every single state matters right here. The fact that you're here because other people laid down their lives is the reason why we need to be all together in this fight to destroy, to cripple, to demolish, dismantle racism. The only way we stop it is by having these conversations. It's okay to have them. We are made to be different. Yes, you are darker. That's okay. Yes, you have fair skin. That's okay. Yes, you do have white privilege. Maybe not okay, but we have to talk about it. But we have to talk about it. And we have to see, why does this affect what's currently going on today? Because I never thought from watching NWA Straight Outta Compton, going back to my past, everybody who's the old school know about that movie, you know what I'm saying? I was watching, I was like, oh, man. And some of that movie, I didn't like how they played the brothers like they were just all romantics. These guys was yelling bees, bees, and all this type of stuff. But we ain't gonna talk about that. But when I watched how the police treated my brothers and my sisters back then, and I remember being in that time, tell me what has changed. When you talk to a police officer nowadays, and I've talked to plenty of them, they will tell you that we have to build a relationship with the community. You ain't never had no relationship with the community. And for the brothers and sisters that want to go into law enforcement, be very aware, be very clear. Anything that you get into, whether it's corporate America, whether it's in sports, you fall into a fraternity. And once you say, I'm going to make changes in this police precinct, and I'm going to do this, man, when you got five brothers or five dudes approaching you talking about, man, you need to keep your mouth shut about what we did. Yeah, we robbed them drug dealers. What? You want to make it home? I think I'm just going to be right here robbing just like you. It's the reality. So we have to not only fight within the inside, we have to fight without in the outside as well. And understand what you're going to do in this school, obtaining, getting it. It is great because it shows that you guys have made it, you're going, and you're striving. But what you give back is the most important thing. What you obtain for yourself is just one part of the issue. What you give back is what is the bigger picture, and that's what everyone should be striving for. Not about what I'm going to get, what I'm going to give back. And not worried about what money I'm going to get, what car I'm going to get. What I'm going to give back to make the social changes that's going to make my brother and sister feel good. That's going to make my kids not have to fight this battle. We fight the same battles that Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, these brothers fought. How are we fighting this in 2015? So for anybody to sit there and even think for 1 minute that you are okay and you're comfortable in America, I have to tell you, you're dead wrong. And you're not being responsible for yourself, the others before you, and your ancestors. You need to step up, step out, start being uncomfortable, and start creating these conversations for any brothers that's dating a white girl. Have that conversation. Well, babe, I was just really thinking that I don't want to hang out with Todd and them anymore. Why, babe? Have that conversation. Some of y'all are like, dang, I don't know, man. Talk to Susie. For my white comrades, have that conversation. Have that conversation at dinner time with all your white friends that feel like everything is okay. Those black people are just, they just need them. Just give them something, they'll be okay. Have that conversation. Be pointed. Ask them, do you think it's fair that these officers keep on beating these murder cases? Because see, the thing about what they do, they try to trick us. They're trying to give us indictments. Yeah. Oh, yay! Because we're marching, because we're tearing up stuff. And then some people say, what are those black people doing? We're tearing up the place. These places ain't ours! None of this stuff is ours! What black person you know owns CBC? None of these blocks are on. That's why I be laughing when brothers yell at me. You talk about, this is my black, bro. See the black owns? Bro, you paying rent, man. If you don't own this, get up out of here. But the truth and reality, make those conversations that you have on a regular, because when we have these conversations, we start looking within ourselves, changes start happening. Okay? When we start looking at the politicians, and it's going to be a hard year to vote 2016. And it looks ugly right now. And that's what y'all got to look. Donald Trump say what he want, when he want. We about to hope that these nuts gets up there fast. I'm going to say, I don't know what he look like, but if he look like you, you'll be better than Donald Trump. Honest, let's go back to this on a serious note. When you hear a white face whose word is privilege say the things that he says, not only about African Americans, but about immigrants, the Hispanic people working. When you hear him talk about, and we're all immigrants, the natives were here before us. When you hear that, you should be very clearly worried on what is going to happen to you and the ability for you, because some of us is on our way out. You, this generation now, is going to have to raise up and move forward. So you should clearly pay attention less to the media gossip, less to Kim and Khloe and who they dating and how Kim's butt's getting bigger. Or Tiger and this transgender people he dated. Keep it at 100. Less to that and to more on the reality. Because our generation, we slipped. Because we thought it was all good. Gave us a little bit of money. Basketball players were flying. I want to be like Mike. Rap music was cool now. We get to play it in our school dance. Oh, I love these guys. Everybody was making a little money. We had a black president by the name of Bill Clinton. It was all good. So we dancing. We off the crab. We good. But then our good friend Bill Clinton gave us 3 strikes. Family signed all on that. They want them all to go to jail. You want all these black people to go to jail. We kept on dancing, people became more ignorant. Rap music wasn't ours no more, they took that. Gangster rap took over conscious rap. Media propelled us, put these images, and now we're exactly where we're at because we gave them power that we should have held on to ourselves. So in the true reality, this is our opportunity and this is our time. Now, all my brothers and sisters, all my soldiers, for us to take back what is ours, take back what is the people's, if this Constitution is true on what it states, if this America was really built on what it was said to be built on, let us truly get equality. Let us truly become a people organized into moving what no longer works for us because they have showed their face. Let us move forward. And let us all end racism. I leave with this. Black people are the most powerful people, but the most powerless people because we don't use our power. People, I say.